good. We're going to look at it together. Let's read it together, please. A cheerful heart is a good medicine, but a downcast spirit dries up the bones. Say it again. A cheerful heart is a good medicine, but a downcast spirit dries up the bones. Earlier on the screen, there was a picture of the word happiness. Happiness. You saw some images of people jumping in various postures, various positions that show there's some joy in those jumps. Amen. Last week we started a series of messages on the subject of happiness. And you might recall that I acknowledged some feelings of concern of taking on such a topic during this season. In fact, somebody sitting here today might be thinking, well, happiness? Come on, preacher. That seems a little advised to me to be teaching on happiness with all that's going on in the world. I'd rather hear a message on justice. I'd rather hear a message on righteousness. I'd rather hear a message on service. I might rather hear something that addresses some of the evils of society. And I realize that. I understand it. I know with whom I am speaking this morning. I suspect someone, when you got up and put your clothes on, you said, I'm going to church. Your soul has been burdened. Can you say amen?
Amen.
I'm looking at somebody today that might say, well, brother preacher, my soul is really, I really haven't got over what happened in South Carolina. I'm still burdened by the senseless killing. I can imagine that I can be in church worshiping the sovereign God of the whole universe, and somebody loses their life. Somebody's burdened by what happened. Still burdened by what happened in South Carolina. Brother Marvin, somebody is burdened today by what they saw on the video of the traffic stop in Texas. The ugliness with which that man spoke to the woman. Somebody's further burdened by the questions that are surrounding the hanging from the jail cell. And somebody's wondering, how could such a thing happen? My soul is burdened. I can't figure out what happened. And no matter what happened, I don't like it. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Somebody came to church this morning and said, my soul is still burdened by what happened in Texas. My soul is burdened by what happened in South Carolina. And truth be told, just this week, somebody is saying, I can't believe that you can't hardly go to the movies anymore to enjoy popcorn and a soft drink and something in the cinema because somebody crazy got up and just started shooting in the cinema. Maybe as you sit in church this morning, you're saying like Marvin Gaye, what's going on? What in the world is going on? So I realize that somebody might be here looking for a serious commentary on some of the evils of society. You might think it ill-advised that I would be spending week upon week talking about happiness. But I believe, dear brothers and sisters, that this message on happiness is a little more timely than we might have imagined.
Amen.
Because the storms of life are certainly raging.
Yes.
And what I found last week as I was reflecting upon some of the things that I learned last week, and I applied some of that which I learned last week, that I was glad that when the storm hit, that I knew something about happiness. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
I hope I'm not by myself here today. I believe that somebody learned something last week from this powerful passage of Scripture. It's up on the screen. A cheerful heart is good medicine.
Amen.
But a downcast spirit dries up the bones. You all might have learned it from the King James. A merry heart doth good like medicine. Would you say the word medicine?
Yes.
But a broken spirit drieth the bones. How about this translation will come upon the screen? A joyful heart is a good medicine, but depression drains one's strength. And I see some of you nodding your heads today because you understand the difficulties associated with the clinical designation of depression. And I want to say right up front that I'm not at all discounting the seriousness of a clinical evaluation of a depressed state of mind. And I don't want to at all make anybody to believe that I fully understand what to do. I'm glad that you're getting the counseling that you need. And I realize that depression is real. And I also know that you may have never had a real designation of depression. But most of us know what it feels like to not feel like getting up in the morning. Most of us know what it's like to want to turn off the cell phone, pull down the shades, and don't be bothered with nobody. Oh, I can't get a witness to that. Oh, I'm not by myself in here. Oh, you can be dressed up on the outside, but jacked up on the inside. So maybe, just maybe, it's not advised to be talking about happiness, because if we ever needed one of the great tools in the arsenal of God's bag, we need it right now. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So here's the last one that's going to come up on the screen from the message. A cheerful disposition is good for your health. Say amen.
Amen.
But gloom and doom leave your bone tired. And so if your energy is sapped, if there's no brightness in your eyes, if there's no pep in your step, if folks are looking at you and saying, I can't believe you got all of those blessings, but you still got a sour disposition, maybe, just maybe, you're in the right place at the right time. Because I intend to be very purposeful to talk about this matter of happiness. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
And so, by way of review, last week I gave you three words that start with W. We talked about the what of happiness, and I spoke to you that happiness is positive emotions that deal with the current and deal with the future. If you don't have a positive disposition and a positive outlook for the future, then it's not likely that you're going to have any happiness in the present. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And so we looked at the what of happiness, and then we looked at the wisdom of happiness. And in that part of the text, I tried to explain the wisdom of fully understanding this business of happiness. And what I argued from several books, these are my commercials, amen. This book right here called The Happiness Advantage by Sean Aker, and this book called The How of Happiness by Sonia Lubomirsky. Both of these books are very good primers. They're not Christian books, but they are definitely rich and full of information. And so in both of these books, we learn the wisdom of happiness that lets us know that when you are happy, it gives you what you need to facilitate those things in life that you're looking for. It's good for your health. It's good for your creativity. It helps you to have better friends and better relationships. It helps us to have better community. We need some happy folks in our lives. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So we learned something about the wisdom of happiness. But the last thing we dealt with was the work of happiness. And what I shared with you last week, it bears repeating, anything that is valuable is going to require some effort. Say amen. And for those of you who are like me, trying to exercise a little bit, you realize that if you want a healthy body, you're going to have to put some time in. Josh is a personal trainer. They can't just send him a note and say, send me a good-looking body. You got to put some work in. And so it is. If you want a healthy body, if you want a healthy soul, you got to put some work in. And so I gave you the five things. The first one, spend some alone time with God. Say amen.
Amen.
And then I said, find something to look forward to. You remember last week, we talked about if you have a vacation and if you just put it on your calendar, it might be a year off in advance. But every time you look at the calendar, you start feeling better. There's an expectation. You might not even have the money yet, but you're thankful and you're going to be happy about it. Say amen.
Amen.
All right, stick with me. Commit conscious acts of kindness, spend money on experiences with others, exercise, and exercise your signature strength. And so that's what we dealt with last week. And I don't have time today to fully treat it the way I did last week. And soon enough, it'll be up on YouTube, and you can watch it and experience the blessing. If you want the manuscript, send me an email. I'll send you my manuscript. But last week, we purposely dealt with the first part of the scripture. A cheerful heart is a good medicine. But that's only the part A of Proverbs 17:22. And part B is equally valuable, a downcast spirit, a crushed spirit dries the bones. Can y'all say amen? I don't want to take you too far, but I just want you to know before the next screen comes up, I need you to know that each of us knows somebody that right now is dealing with that crushed spirit. Can you say amen? Huh? That downcast spirit. I wanted to have a little fun with you today, and last week we had the image, because I'm happy. Y'all remember that, right? And we did that last week. We played the music. Room without a roof and all of that, right? We did all that last week, right. But this week, we're going to go back down memory lane, and I'm going to ask you, does anybody remember this book right here? Oh, don't act like y'all don't remember. Some of you say, I told the preacher, what in the world? Walt Disney, Winnie the Pooh, and that one says, and Eeyore too. But that's not the one that I really want, but it's going to do. Who do you see on the top there? It's a donkey, and his name is Eeyore. And Eeyore, in the Walt Disney Winnie the Pooh series, he had a friend whose name was Tigger. All right, Tigger was a little tiger. And Tigger was very enthusiastic, and he was always had a very, very positive outlook and always a great ball of fun. Contrast Tigger with Eeyore, the donkey. And Eeyore was always downcast with a crushed spirit. And a book that I used to read and Denise used to read, we used to read it to Rachel and Jay, our children, was the book that I thought was going to be up on the screen. But the book was called Eeyore Be Happy. Is it right here? And so what you see is Winnie the Pooh with a big smile on his face and Eeyore with his sorry downcast self. Amen. And so Eeyore Be Happy is all these tales of Winnie the Pooh and his friend. What's his friend's name? Anybody remember? Thank you. Piglet. It's Winnie the Pooh and Piglet trying to do all they can to get Eeyore's sorry self some happiness. Now somebody looked at me crazy and said, are you serious, preacher? I didn't come to church to be hearing no Winnie the Pooh. This is ridiculous. But I need you to know that there's some Eeyores in our families. Lord have mercy. There's some Eeyores in the church. There's some Eeyores in our community. There's some folk that seem like no matter what you do, you can't bring a smile to them. Is there anybody here that can at least raise your hand and say amen? Somebody know that you had to put Eeyore off of your Facebook. Lord have mercy. Some of you had to unfriend Eeyore. Some of you, when Eeyore comes up on your caller ID, you got to say, not today, I can't feel Eeyore. Amen. And sometimes I'm in church, and I've been preaching to my underwear is wet. Talking about the goodness of the Lord, and I see Eeyore looking at me. What I got to do? As good as the Lord has been. Sometimes Eeyore comes to church and you can talk about how he died and how he rose and how he blesses and how he pardons and how his grace is sufficient, how he opens up the windows of heaven and pours out a blessing, and folk look like they're baptized in lemon juice. Lord have mercy. Amen. And that's why I brought Winnie the Pooh. Because Eeyore need to be happy. Sometimes I find that Eeyore spirit jumping on me. Amen. And I say, as blessed as I am, there is no justification for me to have a frown on my face. Amen. As good as the Lord has been, somebody ought to pull my pants down and whip my butt behind me being frowned up and resentful and ugly acting. And I know I'm not by myself in here. That's why I want to talk about happiness. Because if there's ever a group who needs to deserve some of that happy, it needs to have some of that happy, it's us. Let the church say amen. Amen. So things that I talked about last week is the fruit of the Spirit, love and joy and peace and patience, goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control. I listed them. And I said to myself, if the Spirit, say the word Spirit. If the power, say the word power. The power of the Spirit of the Holy Ghost is on you, then you should see some manifestations of some of the fruit of the Spirit shall bring forth some of that happiness. And so I said, you know what? That's a great list. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, generosity, faithfulness, and self-control. But there's a word that's not on the list that the more I thought about it, the more I realized that I had to come back and talk to you about it. And that word is gratitude. Say it with me, please. I want to see happiness. You need a move in your life. Got to spend some time, Reverend Davis, in the Bible talking about happiness. I'll put some scriptures on the screen for those of you who are Bible readers. Look at the first one, 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Let's say it together, please. Whatever happens, give thanks, because it is God's will in Christ Jesus that you do this. If you learn it from the King James, in all things give thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you. The scripture says, in every circumstance, and what I have found out is that if you grow in God, you'll come to a place where you'll be able to even see how God's hand of favor is working when it doesn't even look like it. Can you say amen?
Amen.
There is a place of gratitude for the mature Christian today. And so 1 Thessalonians 5:18 is on the screen. Let's look at the next one from the book of Psalms, Psalm 136, 3 and 4. Say it with me, please. Give thanks to the Lord of Lords. His love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, his love endures forever. Are you thankful today for his great wonders? Are you thankful today that he's the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings? James Cleveland had it right when he said, can't nobody do you like Jesus? His love endures. You're never going to find a time when God is not steady loving you. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Oh, I'm glad about it. So it makes me, Reverend Davis, have a spirit of gratitude. Say it with me, gratitude. But here's the other one, the last one from Psalm 30. And I want you to read it together, and we're going to get this thing. I want you to pay attention to all that God does in this psalm. Together, please. I will praise you, Lord, for you have saved me from my enemies. You refuse to let them triumph over me. Oh, Lord, my God, I pleaded with you, and you gave me my help again. Hallelujah. You brought me back from the brink of the grave, from death itself. And here I am alive. Yeah, yeah. Oh, sing to him, you saints of his. Give thanks to his holy name. Look at verse 5. His anger lasts for a moment. His favor for a lifetime. Look at this. Weeping may go on all night, but in the morning there is joy. In my prosperity, I said, this is forever. Nothing can stop me now. The Lord has shown me his favor. He has made me steady as a mountain. Then, Lord, you turn your face away from me and cut off your river of blessings. Suddenly, my courage was gone. I was terrified and panic-stricken. I cried to you, O Lord. Oh, how I pled. But here comes the good news right here. Please. Then he turned my sorrow into joy. He took away my clothes of mourning and clothed me with joy, so that I might sing glad praises to the Lord instead of lying in silence in the grave. Oh, Lord, my God, I will keep on thanking you forever. Say it with me. Oh, Lord, my God, I will keep on thanking you forever. Say it again. Oh, Lord, my God. I will keep on thanking you for forever. That, look here. I don't know how much you know about Psalm 30. I know that you will learn it from the King James. I will extol you, O God. You brought me up also out of an horrible pit. This is a man who obviously has gratitude in his heart. Say amen.
Amen.
And so today, brothers and sisters, if you don't have nothing to be thankful for, once you get out of Psalm 30 and watch the happiness meter start to move, grateful for saving me from my enemies, grateful for giving me my health again, grateful for sparing my life, grateful for his forgiveness, grateful for turning my morning into dancing. Is there anybody here that knows that God will turn your situation around? Let's clap our hands for Jesus. And so that psalmist says, I'm going to sing God's praise forever. I got something to thank God for. Can you say amen?
Amen.
As long as the blood is running warm in your veins,
amen.
There ought to be gratitude. And I'm trying to argue persuasively this morning that gratitude, say gratitude. Thankfulness, say thankfulness. Leads to an increase in your happiness. Now, all this we done put forth, Eeyore, be happy. All this we learned today about a cheerful heart that doth good like medicine, all of that is foundational, the scriptures that I've given you, because you want to have an understanding, and then you want to have application, you see. You see, what I know is sometimes we come to church, and all of this is going on, but unless we apply it in our lives, it's like going in one ear and out. It's just as good as I just be up here entertaining you.
Amen.
So last week I gave you some step by step work that you could do. And today I'm going to help you with this whole idea of gratitude. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
And this is why I think gratefulness will move the happiness meter. So there are going to be three things that come up on this screen. Here's the first one. When we are grateful, we get to savor positive moments. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Say it with me, please. When we are grateful, we get to savor positive moments. Thank you, Leslie, for that beautiful image. Look at that moment right there, huh? It reminds me of that commercial that says, it doesn't get any better than this. The word savor is in bold print today, capitalized, because most of us understand this word savor. And I want to argue that when you spend time being grateful, it allows you to savor some positive moments. When I think of the word savor, I think of barbecue. Oh. Some barbecue is so sweet to you. Ooh, after about 2 hours, you can still feel it on your tongue. Oh, don't act like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. You know you eat barbecue. Savor. It's just good. It's good. Good to the last drop. Good. So it is with some experiences in life. Every time you think about it, you just say, boy, that was, ooh-wee. Can you say amen?
Amen?
So I'm arguing today that gratefulness, a thankful heart the Bible implores us to have, will move the happiness meter in the right direction. Because over and over and over, as you reflect upon how wonderful it is, then your happiness meter keeps, and every time you think about it, you get a smile on your face. Can you say amen?
Amen.
This morning I got on my cell phone and I sent a text message to my daughter in Philadelphia, and I sent a text message to my daughter here in Los Angeles, and I told them that I thank God that God has allowed them to be my daughter. Why? Because when I think about how good my children have been to me, that's enough for me to savor. Amen. It don't have to be that way.
Yes.
Choose something that allows you to savor the moment. Amen. Here's the second one. When we are grateful, I don't know what that picture is right there. It looks like somebody chanting. They're meditating, okay. They're meditating on Jesus. Listen, imagine. Right? All right, meditating on Jesus, right? When we're grateful, we neutralize negative emotions. Say it with me. When we are grateful, we neutralize negative emotions. What you mean, Pastor? Well, I'm trying to talk about how we're going to move the happiness meter, and the Bible calls us to be thankful, and so we want to see the meter moving to the right, and here's what I want you to know. Are y'all ready? Say ready.
Ready.
I found out you can't be grateful and hateful at the same time. Oh, I need some help in here today. I'm going to say it again. I found out you can't be grateful and hateful at the same time. One of the things that is challenging our society, one of the things that is challenging our community, is that we've got some feelings of bitterness and resentful and some hateful hearts. And if somehow we can remember what the Word of God says, that all things work together for good to those that love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. I might not be able to thank God for the person, but I might be able to thank God for the lessons that I learned from dealing with that crazy person. Amen. I know I'm right about it. Yeah. And so it helps us to neutralize, to mitigate some of the messes in our lives, neutralize some of the negative emotion. You don't believe me? Just start thanking God for all that He's done in your life. And some of them dark clouds of despair will start leading you, thanking that He brought you through, thanking that it didn't take you out, thanking that you're still here on this journey. Amen. Some of that negative emotion will leave you. Church, say amen. And then here's the last one. When we are grateful, it hinders us from taking things for granted. Say it with me, please. When we are grateful, it hinders us from taking things for granted. And sometimes one of the reasons why we can't have the joy and the happiness is because of something that I learned. I'm going to try to be fancy right quick. Y'all ready? I'm going to try to be fancy, right? I was reading this book because I could say my ABCs. And I was reading this book called The How of Happiness. And I learned this phrase, and I couldn't wait to share it with you because it's going to make me seem like I'm smart. Y'all ready? It's called Hedonic Adaptation. Ooh-wee. See? And some smart folks like Denise has got a master's degree in counseling, and Crystal's got fancy letters behind her name. No, hedonic adaptation, hedonism, dealing with pleasure. Say the word pleasure. And so what I found is this notion of hedonic adaptation is this, is that you ever wonder why you got to keep on getting stuff to make yourself feel better, huh? Y'all don't have to say amen. I know it's true. And so what happens is hedonic adaptation means that only for a period of time does something that you acquire bring you hedonism or pleasure. And after a period of time, and it's a short period of time, your mind starts to adapt and you start feeling just like you did before you had the situation. All right? And so hedonic adaptation says that if you're not careful, you start to take things for what? Granted. One study showed that after 2 years, folks who are married start to have hedonic adaptation. So after 2 years in a typical marriage, the husband starts to take for granted his wife, the wife starts to take for granted her husband, and before long, they feel the same level of happiness that they felt before they got married. That's why your marriage got to be based upon something more than just some fleeting feelings. Let the church say amen. Better have something more than my boo makes me weak at the knees. Oh, no. So So what I'm saying is, since hedonic adaptation is real, then we have to be careful lest we start taking things for what? Granted. I'm gonna help somebody today. All right, here it is. For one of those seasons in my life, every day I would go shopping. And I go to those places that have things on sale. Good quality stuff on sale. And I get a little thrill when I bought something that was real good quality and on sale. Y'all act like y'all don't know anything about what I'm talking about. It's okay. It's all right. I'm coming down your street anyway, right? Well, what I found out is that the enjoyment associated with buying a nice garment on sale, it doesn't last very long. And you know how I know? Because I was in my closet some time ago, and I found something beautiful with the tag still on it. So you might say, well, I don't have that problem, preacher. But it's something else you're taking for granted. So let me bring it all together. Today, I want all of us to pause and give some thought to what God has done for each of us here. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Don't miss your blessing. Right up here. Don't miss your blessing.
Amen.
Pause and give some thought to what God has done for each of you in here. Every one of us, do the exercise. Now, let me give you some categories. He has created us.
Amen.
He has provided for us.
Amen.
He has been gracious unto us.
Yes.
He has extended us a relationship with Him that rights the wrongs we have done.
Great.
He has given us vision and given us purpose and given us destiny. He has filled us with power, sufficient power to have victory over the enemy. He has granted us eternal life in His kingdom, which will last forever and ever and ever. And if we just chose one of those each day and chose three implications of just one of those things, our happiness meter is going to have to move. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Wake up. God is up to something.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. On his way back.
He's up to something.
Oh, yeah. He's ready.
I just believe today.
Oh, yeah.
Now is the time to look at this topic of happiness.
Oh, yeah.
Let me tell you why. When I have an Eeyore spirit, I'm not likely to be very good at leading somebody to Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Somehow, some were taught that people who have happiness and smile and laugh and talk loud, some people were taught that that is unrefined and lacking in intelligence. But if you don't have no happiness, you're lacking intelligence. Because what doth it profit to have everything and no joy? Huh? What good would that be? Huh? What good would that be? Just don't have no joy. Have everything. Got to keep on buying and acquiring and doing tricks and trinkets and toys. And still can't find nothing but an Eeyore spirit.
Oh, yeah.
I'm coming against it today. Because unfortunately I've seen it in my own life sometimes. And I want victory over it. I want to be a happy fella all the time. As good as the Lord has been. I'm going to try it. Won't you try it too?
Yeah.
Take one of the attributes of God. Get you out of the spiral notebook and just every day, three things that were associated with it or how you benefited from it.
Oh, yeah.
And see, won't God move in your life? The joy of the Lord is our strength.